Anglican Church. Today is the 23rd Sunday after Trinity Sunday, but we are celebrating All Saints Day, which was November 1st. One thing I want to point out is the opening seasonal greeting. Our response is actually in our bulletin insert thing. I always forget to tell you all that when it's something different than what we normally do, but it's that first couple of lines right there, so just so we won't get too lost. Danica, do you want to come up and...
We're gonna have a woman's Christmas tide party on January 4. It's gonna be a book exchange unless you have some other gift that's inexpensive. That means something to you. Go ahead and bring that. Bring a snack. Invite friends. Whoever you want to invite, just bring them along. I'm gonna be switching the book study to the first Saturday of the month. That works better for our family. We'll be around more. And then also, I just really want to get in the habit of opening my home. Father John has asked me to be part of the outreach, which is really hard with a two-year-old. So Saturdays, the first Saturdays of the month, probably about till mid-afternoon, if you want to stop by, not related to the book for any reason, and just talk, just come to my house. It's open. So that's what I have to contribute.
Thank you, Danica.
Other announcements. Oh, Father John updated our website, so if you haven't seen it, it's pretty cool. The website address is in the bulletin. Wednesday evening prayer at 6:30 at Cheryl's house, and again, the Cascadia Diocesan Women's Retreat information. Their registration opens December 6th. Father John has also printed new invitation cards. The other ones are still out there, but there's new ones, and they are start a new season at Christ the Redeemer Anglican Church. It's pretty cool. So invite a friend to come join us for everything. And haven't mentioned in a while, Connect Cards. This is a great way to connect with Father John or somebody in the vestry if you need to. If you want prayers or if you want to schedule confession if you can't make it before church or anything else. Father John, do you have anything?
No, I'd just like to thank Danica for her being so willing to open up her home. I mean, this is a great opportunity just to build community, to hang out, talk, read a good book. And it's also, as she said, invite friends. She's opening her house. And so this is a very threatening way for people. Right. But, you know, people who may not come to church, but it's like, kind of wondering, you know, what does Christian life look like? Well, this is how it's lived out in people's homes and in community. So I would encourage all of you not only to go, well, if you're a lady in the church, and to invite your friends. So thank you.
Our processional hymn is number 491, hymn 491.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her.
Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Forever. Amen. Worthy is the Lord our God. Let us pray together. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Upon these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Kyrie, Kyrie, eleison, eleison, Christe, Christe, eleison, eleison. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtues and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Sirach. Let us now praise famous men and our fathers in their generations. The Lord apportioned to them great glory, his majesty from the beginning. There were those who ruled in their kingdoms and were men renowned for their power, giving counsel by their understanding and proclaiming prophecies. Leaders of the people in their deliberations and in understanding of people's learning, wise in their words of instruction. Those who composed musical tunes and set forth verses in writing. Rich men furnished with resources, living peaceably in their dwelling places. All these were honored in their generations and were the glory of their times. There are some of them who have left a name so that their praises are declared, and there are some who have no memorial, who have perished as though they had not lived. They have become as though they had not been born, and so have their children after them. But these were, nevertheless, men of mercy, whose righteous deeds have not been forgotten. With their descendants it will remain, a goodly inheritance to their posterity. Their descendants stand by the covenants, their children also for their sake. Their posterity will continue forever, and their glory will not be blotted out. Their bodies were buried in peace, and their name lives to all generations. Peoples will declare their wisdom, and the congregation proclaim their praise. Here ends the reading.
Let the faithful be joyful with glory. Let them rejoice upon their beds. Let the praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hands to inflict vengeance on the nations and to rebuke the peoples. To bind their kings in chains and their nobles with of iron, that they may execute judgment upon them as it is written. Such have honorable the faithful. Praise the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let's be seated.
A reading from the Epistle to the Ephesians. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Let us stand for the proclamation of the Holy Gospel. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. Of all the earth, is the King of creation. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
And Jesus lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil, on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in the heaven. And so their fathers did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. To one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also, and from one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you, and from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish others that others would do to you, do so to them. If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is it to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you will be called sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. Be merciful, even as your Father is merciful. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Alleluia, alleluia. Give praise to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Give praise to
his name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Please be seated. Today, we celebrate All Saints Day. And I want to talk about a topic that affects many of us more deeply than we may care to admit. Shame. Shame is something that has darkened my life, and perhaps, if you're honest, it has yours as well. And the reason why I want to talk about shame today is because of our great and high calling to become saints. It does little to preach about being a saint and running the race well if shame from the get-go is holding you back from even appearing at the starting line. So as we begin, I would like to start with a story of one of the church's most compelling saints, Saint Mary of Egypt. Mary's life is a powerful testimony to God's transforming grace, which called her out of deep shame and into a life of holiness. In her youth, Mary left home and traveled to Alexandria, where she gave herself to a life of unrestrained indulgence and sin. Driven by shame and a deep need that she herself didn't understand, she spent years in pursuit of pleasure and distraction. According to the traditional account of St. Mary of Egypt's life, she lived a life of extreme sexual promiscuity for pleasure alone. Even engaging in relationships, you know, without payment, but just to do it. When she felt compelled to travel to Jerusalem for the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross, she had no money to cover her fare, so she persuaded a group of sailors to take her along in exchange for sexual favors. This account of her story underscores the depth of her brokenness and shame, and the profound nature of her conversion. When she attempted to enter the church in Jerusalem, something strange happened. She found herself unable to cross the threshold. It was as though an invisible barrier had held her back. In that moment, Mary became profoundly aware of her sin and brokenness, and she was overwhelmed with shame. Instead of fleeing, she knelt down and cried out to the Virgin Mary, asking for the Lord's forgiveness. She was given the grace to enter the church, where she encountered God's love in a way that changed her life forever. She felt everything, she left everything behind and fled to the desert, spending decades in repentance and prayer. She transformed into a woman of extraordinary holiness, freed from her past and drawn deeply into God's love. Her life became a testimony that even the deepest shame
can be healed by God's mercy. Now, I understand some of you, some of us, among us, may not fully embrace the veneration of the Virgin Mary, and I want to assure you that that's not the point of my sharing this story about St. Mary of Egypt. St. Mary of Egypt lived in the 4th and 5th centuries, around 344 to 421 AD, a time when devotion to the Virgin Mary was a natural part of Christian life. God worked within her context, of the context of her era, to reach her in a powerful way, using her reverence for the Virgin Mary to open her heart and lead her to a life of holiness. Her story reminds us that God meets us, each of us, where we are, in our context, to bring him to himself. In St. Mary's case, her encounter began with a cry to the Virgin Mary, but it led her straight to the mercy and grace of Christ, who transformed her life beyond what she could have imagined. So today I want to speak about shame in light of St. Mary's story and the communion of saints. St. Mary's life reminds us that shame does not have the final word. As we look at today's readings, we'll see that our place among the saints is not earned by perfection. Instead, it's a gift of grace, and God invites each and every one of us to live free from shame, embraced by his love and part of his holy people. All Saints' Day is the day the church sets aside to remember, a time to remember and celebrate the communion of saints, those who have gone before us, those who walk alongside us, and those yet to come. We remember them, not to lift them above us as untouchable examples, but to be seen as the same, as a part of the same community of faith that God invites each of us into. We're not just invited to admire their lives, but to follow their footsteps, living faithfully with the hope of joining them in God's eternal kingdom. So let's start with a definition. Shame is that deep feeling that we're not good enough, that we're not holy enough, that we've somehow missed the mark, or that we're somehow disqualified from the love of God. Now, we have to be careful here. The truth is, except for that last point, these are all true. We're not good. We are not holy. And we've all missed the mark of God's perfection. But it is, ironically, our acknowledgement of these facts that qualify us for God's love. It is those who believe that they are good and holy who miss out on God's love for them. After all, Jesus is the friend of sinners, not the self-righteous. As Jesus tells us in Mark 2:17, those who are well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. Furthermore, shame is a feeling of embarrassment or humiliation that arises from the perception of having done something dishonorable or immoral or improper. Just because of who you are, not necessarily having to do with anything you did. And of course, there are times when we have done things that are dishonorable, immoral, or improper. And we rightly feel guilt when we do. The difference between shame and guilt is important to understand. Guilt is feeling bad about what we have done. And I must make amends. Shame says, I am bad, and therefore I am unacceptable. Of course, there is biblical and theological truth to the idea that we're bad. Jesus tells us that we are actually evil, right? In Matthew 7:11, Jesus says, if you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? When it comes to goodness, only God is good. Jesus says in Mark 10:18, no one is good except God alone. The problem is that shame says to you, you are uniquely, you and yourself are uniquely bad and unworthy of love and acceptance. And so there is ironically a touch of pride in shame. Whereas Jesus says that we are all evil apart from God's grace, shame says that I alone am evil and unacceptable among others who are relatively good and acceptable people. People who experience shame usually try to hide the shame they feel. And to shore up this, we try to shore up this through arrogance or perfectionism, position, prestige, career, appearance, etc. When shame is chronic, it can involve the feeling that you fundamentally are flawed. You and you alone. Hence the pride. Again, ironically. And so while shame is a negative emotion, it does play a part in our survival as a species, right? Without shame, we may not feel the need to adhere to cultural norms or follow laws or behave in a way that allows us to exist as social beings. Such people are sociopaths. However, shame can be problematic when it becomes internalized and results in an overly harsh evaluation of oneself as a whole person. And this inner critic might tell you again that you're a bad person, worthless. You have no value. And the truth is how deeply ashamed, how deeply ashamed you feel often has little to do with what you've actually done or your actual worth. But when you see it for what it is, shame is actually a denial of the work of God on the cross. It is arrogant to say that Jesus' sacrifice on the cross is sufficient for everyone's sins except mine. It is pride that says that God's love is for everyone except me. St. Paul says in Romans 5:8, God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The Apostle Paul did not carve out an exception for you. And I don't say this to, shame you, but to point out that there is nothing special about you or me when it comes to the grace of God or Jesus' sacrifice for you. You know, shame could have a positive effect in that it could allow us to see that, right, yes, I am undeserving of God's grace. However, ironically and insidiously, it puts grace in the category of something that is deserved. Others deserve grace. I don't. So it is true for those who are in Christ, shame can still linger. And it not only lingers for some of us, but defines us and crushes our spirit. Shame is something that distorts our sense of identity in Christ. So it is good that the church reminds us today that sainthood is not about being perfect or sinless. It's about being redeemed by God's love, freed from shame, and invited into a life of repentance and faithfulness. This is, in fact, especially poignant on All Saints' Day, where we remember all those whom we call saints, who are often broken, flawed, and familiar with shame, like Saint Mary, but whom God made radiant by his grace. Saints are not those who are without flaws, but they are those who live without shame because they are securely rooted in God's love. As we reflect on today's readings, we're also invited to see our place in this communion of saints and to consider how shame might hold us back and keep us from fully embracing it. and Sirach, we hear the author's call to praise famous men, the ancestors who have gone before. And the text begins with the words, verse 2. The Lord apportioned to them great glory, his majesty from the beginning. Emphasizing that what made these men and women significant was not their human fame, but God's hand on their lives. Some are remembered for wisdom, others for leadership, and still others were quiet and unknown, their names forgotten. Yet the author assures us that their legacy remains eternal, for their glory will not be blotted out. God remembers each one. This passage acknowledges both the well-known saints and the unsung faithful. It also speaks directly to those who may feel unworthy of sainthood or struggle with a sense of shame and inadequacy. Shame often whispers in our ears that we are less than those around us, that others are more deserving of grace and love. But Sirach reminds us that God honors the legacies of each person, whether they made history or lived quietly, lived their life out quietly in faith. On this All Saints Day, our Lord reminds us that sainthood isn't about worldly recognition, but about faithfulness. Those who might feel small or unseen in this life are seen and remembered by God. This reminds me of the story of Hagar in Genesis 21, the mother of Ishmael and Abraham's concubine, who was sent away with her child into the desert in shame by Abraham at the instigation of his wife Sarah. When her child was about to die of thirst, God heard the cries of Hagar and said in verse 17, "What troubles you, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is." Even in the destitution of the desert, our God is the God who hears us. And Hagar's not the only one. We remember the concubine of the Levite, Tamar, Dinah, Naomi, and Bathsheba. The mother of God risked the shame of Saint Joseph and her family and her community because of her faithful and daring yes to God. In all of it, the faithfulness of the saints in great and small ways becomes part of the eternal legacy of God's people. When we think about shame, we often believe that our lives somehow don't measure up. We think we're too broken, too flawed, too unknown to have a place among the saints. But Sirach tells us that even those whose names were forgotten by the world are remembered by God. Their faithfulness has an eternal legacy. This means that sainthood is not about impressing others, but about living humbly and faithfully and wherever and whatever God has called us. Today we celebrate that God honors all who serve him, no matter how visible or hidden their lives may have been. And if you look at the insert in your bulletin, you'll notice that all the well-known saints on the list are mentioned there. But there's also a mention of unknown saints. Yet they too are worshiping God, encircling the throne of Christ. And it's also the icon that we have out on the stand. So whether well-known or unknown, that is the calling of each of us, to take our place among the communion of saints, worshiping our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. In his letter to the Ephesians, St. Paul expands on this theme by reminding us of the divine inheritance we have received in Christ. In him we have obtained an inheritance according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, St. Paul writes. This inheritance is not something we earn or by our merit. Instead, it is the result of God's grace and calling. It's a gift from God. St. Paul prays that we would have the eyes of our hearts enlightened so that we may know the hope to which he has called us. the assurance that we belong to Christ and that God has given us an inheritance in him means that our identity rests in Christ alone. Shame tells us that we're not enough, that we're not worthy of love or belonging. But St. Paul reminds us that it's not our efforts that define us, but God's love and calling. He prays in Ephesians 1:19 that we would understand the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and that we are empowered by the immeasurable greatness of his power. All Saints' Day affirms this truth. We are heirs in the communion of saints, and we share in the same inheritance as those who have gone before us. Saints are not those who became worthy on their own. They're the ones who placed their faith in God's love and allowed him to shape their lives. Just as they were released from shame and embraced God's love, so we are invited into this holy identity. In Christ, we are freed from shame and welcomed into God's family through our one and irrevocable baptism, strengthened by the sacraments that he has graciously given to his church to live faithfully. When we look at the saints, we see how they lived fully into their identity in Christ, recognizing their need for God and trusting in his love to sustain them. We see the beauty of lives lived in the transformative love of God. They did not live without weakness, yet in God's hands they became testimonies of grace. This identity and belonging in Christ, affirmed in Ephesians, calls us to see ourselves as part of this ongoing story of faith. Released from the shame of unworthiness and embraced by God's love as his beloved. In other words, we too are called to live in the freedom that comes from God, from his love, and to embrace our place in this community of faith. And finally, in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus offers blessings and woes that stand in stark contrast to the values of the world. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. This is what Jesus says. And by doing so, he exalts the lowly and the marginalized. He blesses the hungry, the weeping, and the persecuted. And he warns those who are wealthy, comfortable, and well-regarded. These blessings reveal the radical, upside-down nature of God's kingdom, where true blessing is found not in earthly accolades or accomplishments, but in dependence on God and compassion towards others. These words may be difficult to embrace. When Jesus tells us to love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, and your reward will be great, and you will be called sons of the Most High, in Luke 6:35, he isn't calling us to something that's simple. It's not easy. The vision of sainthood is a call to live courageously, even when it means stepping beyond what we're comfortable with. He's inviting us to live out a radical love that mirrors God's own mercy. In fact, Jesus' words speak to a high calling, a sainthood that goes beyond admiration to imitation. Saints are not those who simply have it all together, but are those who see their dependence on God's mercy and grace despite their flaws. They reflect God's love precisely because they are unashamed of their need for him. They were blessed not because of their strength, but because of the strength of God, just as we here today are invited to have. These Beatitudes reveal the true calling of sainthood. Saints are those who have taken this call seriously, choosing to love and forgive rather than to hate and hold grudges. This is a vision of sainthood that is radically different from any worldly accolade or status. Saints are those who know their dependence on God and who do not live for themselves and who choose mercy over revenge and generosity over self-protection. Saints are those who recognize their need for God and their dependence on his mercy. They know that their strength is not their own. And nothing is done by their own efforts, but in God's grace. They allow God's love to transform them, turning their shame, their pain, and weaknesses into acts of love in thought, word, and deed. This is what Jesus is calling us to do today, to live out this love that goes beyond what is easy or natural, and to be open to God's work within us and through us. So, on this All Saints Day, let us remember that saints were not heroes untouched by sin or shame. They were men and women like us, made whole by grace. Their lives became a testimony not to their own power, but to God's work through their faith. They were called to live radically, just as Jesus calls us to live in today's gospel. They embraced their identity in Christ, and in so doing, they were freed from shame. And we too are invited to this life of grace, released from the shame that holds us back. In the communion of saints, we find our place. Each one of us, whether we are known or unknown, great or small, this day reminds us that God has a purpose for each of us, even in our weaknesses and imperfections. We are each called to participate in this legacy of faith, just as those who were called before us. We are invited to live unashamed in Christ, empowered by the same Holy Spirit who empowered all the saints who came before us. May we draw courage from their example, taking up our place within the communion of saints, knowing that our identity and our inheritance rest securely in Christ's love. When I was working on this message this week, I was transported in my mind back to a familiar occurrence when I was a kid in the Baptist church, remembering a hymn that we sang quite often. Maybe these words capture the thoughts of your heart that maybe you dare not speak aloud. And so, as I read them, perhaps you can make them your prayer to Jesus. Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. I come. Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe. O Lamb of God, I come. Whether it's shame or guilt, the weight of sin or the fear of death, the answer is always the same. Jesus, won't you come to the Lamb of God? He who takes away the sin of the world. As we conclude, let's return to briefly the story of St. Mary of Egypt. Don't you want to know how her life ended? And we'll look particularly at the final chapter of her life, a beautiful reminder of God's power to exchange our shame for His glory. After years of repentance and solitude in the desert, St. Mary encountered the monk, St. Zosimus, who had been led there by God. Upon seeing her, he was astonished by her holiness. This once broken woman, who had spent decades struggling with the weight of her past, had been transformed by God's grace into a radiant witness of his love and his mercy. Zosimas brought her the Eucharist, and in profound humility, Mary received it. She knelt in prayer and asked him to return the following year. When he did, he found her body resting peacefully in death, marked by deep holiness, with a note asking him to bury her. And this was a testimony to the peace and grace that she had found in God. St. Mary's story, especially her final moments, reveals that God's mercy and love have the power to redeem and to restore, no matter how far we feel we have fallen. She began in shame, but she ended in glory, united with Christ and forever remembered as a saint. I think she's even on the list. So today on All Saints Day, we are reminded that God's promise to exchange our shame for his glory is as true for us as it was true for Mary. The same God who transformed her life invites each of us to live freely and unashamed in his grace, knowing that our place is among the communion of saints, secure in his love for us. Now unto God, the God of all grace, who is ashamed for us in order to present us without spot or blemish before him, our Lord Jesus Christ, be all glory, wonder, worship, and praise forever and ever. And now let us stand and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he arose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the church and for the world, saying, hear our prayer. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being and unity of the people of God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Stephen, our archbishop, and Jacob, our bishop, and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation, and for St. Barnabas, Anglican Church in Yangon, Myanmar, and Lord of Mercy, Anglican Church. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others,
Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith. Lord, in your mercy, for our nation, for those in authority, for all in public service. Lord, in your mercy, for all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, especially Anderson, Barbara and Brenda, Kathy and Christine, Dave, Fran and Garrett, Jenny and Heather and Jackson, Jay and Jim, Kay and Katie and Kelly, Kelly and Leah and Father Mac. Pray for Meredith and Nevin and Pam, Paul and Rick and Rose, Samantha, Sue, Terry and Terry, Theodore, Trent, Trevor, Will, family in need. Lord, in your mercy, for those who have departed this life and the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving let us pray. Lord, in your mercy, are there any other prayers that we want to lift up to the Lord at this time? Murphy? Connor. Twins. Connor, yes. He's what? COVID? Oh, wow. I guess you still can't get that. All right, we'll remember Max. Is there anything else? Christina. Yes, we do that too. We do lift up Max to you, and we ask you, Lord, to ameliorate his any pains and aches that's going along with the COVID. And we pray that it's a very weakened form and that he gets over it soon, Lord. So we do lift you up to him. And Lord, we do. We give you thanks, Lord, for what you're doing in Christina's life and her family's, and Alex, and it is always good to see you work in the lives of your people. And of course, we know that you do every day of our lives. And I just pray that we remain a people of gratitude and thanks for even these small things. The fact that we get up every morning with breath in our lungs in order that we might serve you that day. So, Lord, we do give you thanks. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised the forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the word of God to all those who truly turn to him. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver.
Thank you.
Let us present our alms to Almighty God. Is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord.
And of your own have we given you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For in the multitude of your saints, you have surrounded us with so great a cloud of witnesses that we, rejoicing in their fellowship, may run with patience the race that is set before us, and together with them receive the unfading crown of glory. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when he had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection he broke the bonds of death and trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, where we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you,
For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all your saints, and among them Elizabeth and Zechariah, the parents of John the Baptist, into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and yours, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us your peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. In peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.